right, very well. If you're ready, we'll begin. I know you have some handouts there, but I just want to give you a little overview of what we're doing here today. Last week on Thursday, on the 21st of February, at about noontime, we were asked by the family of Robert Tisdale to go to the 6,000 block of Fairfield Oaks Lane in Pofftown and check on him and the occupants of that residence. Family members had not seen him in a while. So we went out there, sheriff's deputies, patrol deputies, checked on the house. We entered the house and discovered a deceased person in the house. That body was transported to Chapel Hill for post-mortem examination to determine who that person was. And at that time, we commenced an investigation to locate both Robert Bowie Tisdale and Stephen Byron Tisdale, the known residents of that dwelling, that residence. Also on the same day, Stephen Byron Tisdale was to appear in state court, felony court, on an unrelated felony charges, which he did not do. He failed to appear. So again, we were conducting an investigation to locate him and Robert, and to identify the body that was located in the house midday on February 21st. Our investigation continued on Friday and Saturday. Subsequently, we located Stephen in Las Vegas, Nevada. He was taken into custody based on an order for arrest issued by the Superior Court judge for his failure to appear on those charges, which are not related which were not related to the investigation that we were conducting and still are conducting, actually. As of Saturday, so he's in custody. On Sunday, he's in custody, and today our investigation continues to the extent that we have now proceeded with obtaining first-degree murder warrant, arrest warrants for Stephen Byron Tisdale. The post-mortem examination conducted by the medical examiner's office in Chapel Hill have identified the body of Robert Bowie Tisdale. So that's where we are at this point in time. We brought you here to say that to you as a result of the media interest in this case, which is a very important case in this county, and also for the community's interest, just to let people know that we believe that our investigation has determined the facts in this case, and that the community is safe, and that neighbors and folks in that community do not have anything to fear today. So that's where we are at this point in time. And if you have any questions, as limited as they may be, I will try to answer them. Go ahead.
Any determination as to how long Robert Tisdale had been dead before he was found?
Yeah, he'd been dead some time. Exactly the extent of that time, I cannot tell you at this moment.
You got a call from a family member on February 21st?
Thursday, yes, right.
Okay.
He had been, I believe the post-mortem examination will show that he had been dead for a period of time prior to that. I cannot tell you at this moment how long that has been.
And do you know how long it had been since that particular family member had heard from Robert Tisdale?
I don't have that fact in front of me, but it had been a significant amount of time such that the family member was concerned.
About a week?
I wouldn't speculate, but it had been an inordinate amount of time, causing the family member to be concerned and worried, and asked for us to do what we call a welfare check, is to just go to the residence to see if everything was all right.
It says that Mr. Tisdale had died of a gunshot wound. Is there any evidence of any kind of blunt force trauma?
Gunshot wound is all I have at the moment.
Has the gun been recovered?
Yeah, we are endeavoring to do that, and that's part of the investigation. We're not going to comment about that, but obviously we're looking for the weapon, and we'll continue until we're satisfied with all aspects of the investigation. So it'd be premature for me to speak about that.
Where was Robert's body found in the home?
It was found in the bedroom area of the home, I'm told.
And what condition was it in?
Well, again, I don't want to get into all of that sort of thing, but suffice to say he was deceased as a result of a gunshot wound, and had been there for a number of for an extended period of time, and so all of that will come out once we get complete results of the investigation and a in detailed report from the medical examiner's office.
Based on the scene, was there a sign of a struggle or any kind of motion?
We can't get into all of that in terms of the specifics of the results of the investigation.
You know, where was he shot?
We're not going to speculate, but we're not going to release that information yet. But suffice to say, it was a gunshot wound.
When will Stephen Tisdale be coming back?
Yeah, there's a process, obviously. Obviously, Jim O'Neill.
That's why I'm here. He can speak to that.
District Attorney Jim O'Neill is with us. Those questions, certainly he can answer, but it'll be some time for the legal process to go forward. Jim, if you want to count on a comment at all.
Well, to begin with, the rules of professional responsibility prevent me from commenting or answering your questions regarding the facts of the case, but I can tell you that, generally speaking, there is an extradition process that goes on. The defendant, in general terms, has a right to waive that hearing and just be returned back to the jurisdiction, or he can contest that hearing, in which case there'll be a hearing conducted in Las Vegas or in any other location before an individual is brought back to the county where the warrant is drawn.
What is he going to be in court for tomorrow in Las Vegas?
I can't tell you for sure, but generally speaking, again, when we have cases where we have fugitives from other states or counties, they're given a right to come before a judge and to determine whether or not they want to waive this process, this extradition process, or whether or not they want to contest the validity of the paperwork.
How was he found in Las Vegas? Did he drive, fly? Where was he located?
Well, that's just not a question that, again, because of the rules of professional responsibility, that I just can't answer those questions, and I don't believe the Sheriff's Department wants to get into that either.
But it wasn't for something like a traffic violation that they found him in Las Vegas? Or?
I just can't answer that question at this time.
I apologize if this was already released in a previous release, but was he allowed to be there because of his prior embezzlement charges that he was supposed to appear for? Was he allowed to, you know, leave the state?
Well, he was scheduled to be in court this past Thursday to answer for charges of embezzling money at a Baptist hospital. When he failed to show and appear on those charges, a hearing was conducted in front of the Honorable Judge Wood between myself, who was prosecuting the case, and his lawyer, Chris Beechler. We argued about what we thought a reasonable bond should be set at. I asked the bond to be set at $1 million, and Mr. Beechler countered with $100,000, and the judge decided that $500,000 was appropriate given the significance of the amount of money that had been taken out of Baptist Hospital. This, of course, was all taking place prior to anyone knowing that Robert was deceased.
What's the status of that particular case?
Well, that case is on hold right now. Obviously, there was an order for Mr. Tisdale's arrest for failing to appear in court on those charges, but those charges are still out there and they're on hold.
What was this Tisdale's financial status right before he was scheduled to appear in court for this embezzlement charge?
What was his status?
Financial status, were they at risk of losing their home? I mean,
oh,
did they have an income?
I couldn't answer that question. I really don't know. I was only concerned with seeing too that the Baptist Hospital was being made whole for their amount of damages.
This would probably be directed to you or to Brett Stanley. There have been some neighbors who had said that they had been, that Mr. Tisdale and Stephen Tisdale had been married, maybe in another state. Have you been able to get any certainty on that particular fact? Were they in fact married, or do you know?
I do not. I do not know that. They were living in that residence for a long period of time, and as to their relationship status, I don't know the answer to that.
And as far as you know, was there any kind of, the last time I checked, I didn't see anything, that there wasn't any evidence that law enforcement had responded to that house frequently in the past?
I have no information about that.
Why was it initially said that the gender couldn't be determined?
All these questions are specific, and as we talked about earlier, we're not going to be able to go into those. So that is the information we have at this point. Obviously, as the case continues investigation, maybe more information, but at this point, that'll end our conference. Thank you for being here.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.